Hello everyone and welcome to the 17th episode of the Stack to Eve podcast. On this episode, we are going to be talking with Mithun Shanbhag, who is the creator of a product called CloudsQ. So it was a product that I came across on the front page of HN and I was very interested about the product itself. And then it was very nice to come across Mithun in one of the Slack communities that I was participating in. So immediately once I saw that he's active there as well, I wanted to have this episode with him. Hey, welcome Mithun.
Thanks Manoj, thanks for having me.
Hey, thanks for taking your time and coming on this podcast. Can you start by quickly introducing yourself?
Sure. So my name is Mithun Shanbhag. So I run a small startup called Skewed Ventures. So we are the creators of CloudsQ. So it's a cloud diagramming tool that you generally use for sketching cloud architecture diagrams, AWS, Azure, GCP, Kubernetes. So sort of, for folks who are outside of the tech domain, these are essentially blueprints of a software system. So that's what we primarily do, but we also do consulting engagements on the side. And prior to this, I was working at Microsoft. I worked there for about 12 odd years across 3 or 4 teams, Windows, Common Language Runtime, Visual Studio, Azure Compute. So wore a couple of hats there. And then after, 15 odd years there, I just sort of got bored and decided to start my own thing. So I've been at it for a while now.
So that sets some context on why you wanted to start your own thing. But why CloudsQ and why a diagramming tool in particular? Because especially it's a pretty crowded market already. And I think a lot of developers at some point in time are already using some kind of a diagramming tool, like say Draw.io, Allocitchart, some of them are even integrated into the products that you're already using, like Confluence. So where did the inspiration for it come?
So it is true that the landscape for diagramming tools is crowded, but the landscape for cloud architecture tools is not, right? So and that's the direction we are going in. So let me start by why, I zeroed in on this problem area. So I've been in the cloud computing space for quite a while. And when I first started my startup, we also did a whole bunch of consulting engagements to, have some revenue. A lot of my work was actually creating architecture diagrams, giving out, cost estimates. How much is this architecture going to cost you? What's your cloud spend going to look like? What are your security issues likely to be? What are your performance bottlenecks likely to be? How are you going to address high availability? How are you going to address compliance? So, it's not just the architecture or the blueprint that has to be drawn. You also have to answer like 1,000 questions along with the diagram, there is like a 10-page documentation that addresses all those pillars, if you will. So that starts getting very tedious very fast, right? So let's say you're drawing an architecture diagram for something in the lift and shift space, right? You're lifting and shifting some SQL servers. So yeah, you answer some 10 pages of questions related to that. Then you work on something in the insurance or finance domain. You do some architectures there. And that comes with its own set of compliances and requirements. And there's another checklist that you need to answer. So there is no automated tool that sort of answers all this. Everything is very checklist driven. Everything is very manual, and the planning, the architecture, the planning, it sort of like varies depending on which domain you're working on, what type of product you're working on. Is it a serverless product? Is it a infrastructure as a service product? The way, there's no planner really to help you plan out your cloud architecture deployments. I decided, this is a pain that I have to live every single day of my life as a cloud architecture consultant. So why not just create a tool, right? So step one, yes, it's always the architecture or the blueprint remains central to your planning process. But once you are done with the diagram, there are a whole bunch of checklists that you have to run through. There's a whole bunch of planning activity that you have to run through before you do your deployment. And CloudSQ is sort of like trying to become a cloud architecture planner that helps you, you know, plan out your deployments. Today, most of the unfortunate story is that most of the people, they draw some diagrams and then they actually start the deployments and then they rely on AWS, X-Ray, or, you know, some cloud architecture, advisors, like automated advisors to tell you what your vulnerabilities are, what your performance bottlenecks are, and then they go ahead and fix it. So all of these things can be done pre-deployment, but it just calls out for a tool like CloudSQ to help out with that. So I hope that, I realize it's a little bit of a meandering answer, but I hope that answers where we are going with CloudSQ.
Yeah, I think your focus on some of these aspects. So recently, moving into a more experienced developer position, right? I'm finding myself doing a lot of architecture diagrams. And
yeah.
One particular use case is, apart from communicating to the team, talking about where we are going and all that, I see that some of the primary use cases around things like security. I'm involved with the security team for them to see, okay, hey, can you give me an architecture diagram so that we can then start doing some threat analysis and start doing some pen testing. I see that a lot of the use cases are not really the traditional use cases that we really see. Okay, do some architecture drama. It's not even going to be a static thing. There are a lot of different use cases that we generally don't think about. And then there is the cost aspect as well. What is the cost of the system that you're going to start creating or have in place, right? So I'm sort of getting it like you're targeting those areas, right?
Correct. So when you think about it from the perspective of a well-architected framework, right? So along with the architecture, there are some pillars that you need to address. So the first pillar is called cost optimization. So, you know, how much is this thing going to cost me? How can I optimize my costs? So, second is high availability and resiliency. When you're planning to do things on a global scale, you want to make sure that traffic is served almost always without any downtime. Third is performance and scalability, right? As your site or app grows more popular, the user footprint grows, how do you ensure that it scales automatically? That's third. Fourth is, of course, security. Security is, I don't have to state the importance of security. The fifth one is centered around governance and compliance, right? If you're addressing a market vertical where compliance is required, insurance, healthcare, finance. So they come with their own checklist. So you have to make sure that whatever architecture planning doesn't violate any data sovereignty compliance or HIPAA compliance or anything of that sort. So there are some five verticals that you need to address as part of your architecture process. So yeah, so that's the direction we are headed in.
Yes, that sounds very interesting. So one thing that I wanted to ask here is, so recently what I'm seeing is also that we do some small change to the architecture and then it's out of date again.
Yeah.
So one example that I could have from what we recently did is we have CloudFront, and then to do something specific with CloudFront, we had to write a Lambda at edge function on top of it, which we didn't reflect in the diagram because that was something we did at the last moment to add some headers and so on. And then we were asked question why this wasn't even reflected here, that there is a Lambda at edge running.
Yeah.
On top of the CloudFront that you had.
Yeah.
So I see that some products like Lucidchats also do something like a live version of your.
You bring up an interesting point. See, when I draw parallels with other industries, right? Say for example, you're developing a building, like a 100-story building.
Yeah.
Right. You're developing a food manufacturing plant. Something to do with mechanical engineering. So there is a prime focus on architectures, on blueprints. Like no construction engineer is going to start building a diagram, start building a 100-story building and then draw the blueprint, right? That's going to be chaos because there is construction involved. There is things like lighting, electrical, plumbing. So all of those folks, their teams, they have to share that one central blueprint. And as every floor gets completed, you have to keep updating the blueprint. It's the same for mechanical engineering, floor design. So in software, we tend to do the reverse, where it's primarily because the cost of making a mistake is not that high, right? Like, you screw up something in a chip design. You're developing an instruction set architecture. You're developing Intel's next chip or something like that. You screw up something in the architecture design, that's going to cost you millions or billions of dollars. You screw up something in your construction blueprint, the entire building might fall. So there's a heavy, the replications are pretty heavy. In software world, you forgot to put in CloudFront in your diagram. I think, no big deal. You can always replace that later. So we tend to take those things a little lightly. But as the industry or the market vertical grows more compliance heavy, where you violate a compliance, you violate something like a GDPR compliance or a HIPAA compliance, you're looking at millions of dollars in fine. Then yes, you will start paying attention to those diagrams very fast. So I hope that answers the question.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, I think to repurpose the BDD, right? We can say blueprint driven development now.
Yeah, yeah, I think you have to. And especially when you are working on a large team, across a large organization with multiple teams, one team addressing security, like you said, or one team addressing performance. You need to have this blueprint as this diagram as a central blueprint on which every team is constantly updating and relying on as a source of truth. You can't have teams diverging and doing their own things and then updating the blueprint later. You have to treat the blueprint as a source of truth and then do the implementation.
Yeah, I think that puts some of the features that you're targeting with CloudSQ in even more better perspective for me. I think I'm much more excited to start using CloudSQ also because of these. So could you highlight some of the other features which I came across in your answers in
This is actually best demonstrated over video, but now given that we are doing an audio podcast, I'll try to verbally explain as best as I can. Think of it like a blueprint sketching tool. If you have used AutoCAD in the past, right? Like mechanical engineers use AutoCAD or construction engineers use AutoCAD to draw their blueprint. So this is a similar system where you sketch diagrams for your cloud deployments. So it can be anything as simple as a virtual network with various subnets, or it can be something as complex as a Kubernetes cluster, custom deployments with multiple pods, replica sets, blah, 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 blah. So, at the heart of it, the app itself is pretty simple. You just log in using GitHub or LinkedIn, and then you come across a three-pane editor. So on the left pane, you select which icons you want to drag onto the canvas. So three panes, right? So on the left is the set of icons. In the center is your diagram canvas. And on the right is the properties. So you drag an icon, let's say icon for Lambda or CloudFront or whatever. You drag that onto the canvas and start sketching. And then if you need to change any of the icon properties, like you want to add some text or you want to increase the size of the text or you want to attach arrows or whatever between the various icons. And so you use the property, the third property pane. So it's a simple three-pane app. Now the part, so this is very similar to most sketching tools like Visio, Draw.io, Lucidcharts. The part where it actually starts diverging is we store everything. So it's a SaaS service. So all diagrams are auto-saved on the cloud for you. So you don't have to manage, the versioning of the diagrams or storing it on your own local storage. Everything is persisted automatically for you. The second differentiator is all the resource documentation is baked in. So as in when you're dragging, let's say a Lambda or SQS or, Azure Service Bus or something onto the canvas, you need to look up its documentation. You can just right click on the icon and just access the documentation straight away. So you need access to the pricing calculator or you need access to the SLA docs or just a simple resource documentation. You can just right click on it and just go access that. Other than that, you have the standard features that's available in most diagram editors, templates. You want to, like, for example, creating VPC or a Kubernetes cluster is a time-consuming thing, and it's a, you know, you tend to frequently repeat those. So you can create a stock diagram and save it as a template and then reuse that template time and time again. So that's there. What are the features are there? So it has a whole bunch of icons preloaded. So icons for AWS, Azure, GCP, Kubernetes, Alibaba Cloud, Oracle Cloud, and I think a couple others like Elastic Cloud are there. And that icon set keeps growing. So those are the, and so very soon we'll be adding more things that will help make your pillar planning easy, right? You know, your security pillar, your cost optimization pillar, your governance pillar, your compliance pillar. So when you're sketching your workloads, we'll start introducing more wizards that, you know, help you plan those things better. So that's the direction we are going in.
Nice. Yeah, I think those set of features definitely do differentiate it from some of the other products, yeah, right? Okay. So one thing that I wanted to ask is, as I've already seen, there are like huge set of icons in place already. And mm-hmm. If we take it back to the Terraform community, right, whenever AWS announces a new product, the yeah. community wants to measure how long it takes for the new product to come into Terraform as a resource. Yeah. So what is the challenge for you to add a new icon, right? How are you keeping the icons?
So the good thing is most of the cloud providers, they are pretty active about updating their icon set. So they are available under cloud community, the CC4 license, Creative Commons license, and they are available for use in your tools. Yes, the task of updating the icon set is a pretty tedious one. It's just, you know, but fortunately they don't update it that frequently. It's like once every quarter or something like that, icon sets get updated. So yeah, it's a tedious manual process for me to keep up with the, so for example, right, like last Thursday, I think the Azure service providers, they came up with a new set of icons. So now I have to go update some 150 plus icons sometime later this week. It's a small change, but it's tedious and time consuming. Yes.
So. Okay. Interesting. So, and linking an icon to the documentation and the corresponding SLA or cost pages is also a manual task right now, is it?
It's all JSON schema, you know, described in JSON behind the scenes. Okay. So that part doesn't change much, right? Like the SLA very hardly changes. And every time there is a change, they push out a feed telling you that something has been updated. So as long as you're tracking that feed, I think you're good. Those changes are pretty rare.
All right. So would you say, so one of the questions that I usually ask in this podcast is, after talking about some of the good aspects and what's working very well with whatever someone is doing, right, is asking about the primary challenges in building the product. I guess managing the icon sets is one of the biggest challenges that you have. What other challenges would you say are there with what you're doing right now?
So the challenge is not really on the technical side. It's on the non-technical side of things, right? There are a couple of players in the diagramming space. So building a differentiator and letting the community know that there is a differentiator in this product. So that's like a hard challenge. So there's a whole bunch of SEO optimization work for my landing pages, doing a whole bunch of blog content. So that's where some of my time goes. The technical parts, I'm not really all that worried about, right? I'll figure it out sooner or later. Given that I don't come from the digital marketing background, so those are things that I'm just figuring out for myself. So the SEO content, content management, that's been a bit of a challenge. Other than that, usage has been good. We are almost at 19K users. User signups. It's a free product, so you don't have to pay for anything there. So happy with that number. Majority of the users are cloud architects, couple of cloud consultants as well. Whole lot of adoption from the the Microsoft MVP or the Azure Community Heroes. You know, the developer advocate community. So they are pretty heavy users of the product. We have heavy usage from the training industry as well. Like people use these architectures to put them out on their training slides or in their marketing material. So all that's there. Apart from that, yeah, know the challenges. Like there's nothing that required me to re-architect anything or drastically change the architecture. It has been an iterative process. I started with by releasing a private beta in the last week of December 2019, right? Like the day after Christmas, I think is when I did the private beta. And I think on Jan 9th or Jan 10th, I started the first public preview. And adoption has been growing. A lot of features, their users have requested new icon sets, or they requested some changes in the UX, and it's been a slow iterative process where they request something over GitHub, I go make those changes and get their feedback. So it's been pretty smooth sailing. I didn't have to re-architect anything at this point. Been trying to stay on top of feature requests. And there are plans to come out with like an enterprise version of the product later in the year. So far, this is CloudSQ is a free offering, but for enterprises, we'll come out with a paid offering. So if users want features like bring your own storage or encrypt with your own encryption keys or sign in with your company credentials. So those are some of the features we'll be rolling out as part of the enterprise plan. So that'll be a paid app.
Nice. So after using tools like Draw.io for a long time, right? So I have now gravitated towards this new tool. I'm not sure if you're familiar with it, called Diagrams, which is like I'm not sure how widely used it is. I think I also saw it on HN, but I've been like using it exclusively now for the last few months.
You're referring to the diagram as code, right?
Yeah. So as a developer, I don't know, somehow it feels more natural for me, write the code and then...
As a developer, yes. But the minute you start drawing extremely complicated diagrams, that thing gets very tedious.
Yeah.
And if you're somebody who works in tech pre-sales, right? Like most of my consumers are, most of my users are cloud consulting architects who do pre-sales. So they have to draw a diagram, give a... cost estimate and all that. And they do multiple complicated diagrams per week, right? They're constantly giving out proposals. Yeah. So if you start doing diagram as code for all of that, you are going to have a very, very, very busy job. So there is a place for diagram as code and it is within the developer community. For the consulting community, the adoption has been very difficult.
So after I started using it, right, my main complaints with it are it must always be code. There is no place for me to generate a diagram and then hand over the diagram where now I can then start visually editing it. That has not been there.
Yeah.
And then other thing is the layout, right?
You can't customize the layout. You can't customize it to a great degree.
Like
change arrow colors or all that, but you can't drastically change the layout to your preference. So that's always a challenge.
Yeah. So I think the question that I'm leading to it, is it possible to have something like that? At least if I want to do some developer focused diagrams or even.
No. So the product is not aimed at the developers at all.
Yeah,
the product is aimed at architects, right? I've done a whole bunch of usability studies with architects, with consultants, and the general thing that they are strapped for is time. Time is their biggest constraint. Nobody has time to sketch out. Nobody has time to use diagram as code. You describe your layout in code. The architect community really doesn't, don't really care for it. B, they don't really want it. And C, it is not something they would pay for. So I'm not even going there.
Great. I think from that answer also, I think you mentioned it a bit, is a lot of time spent in understanding what the real use cases are, nailing the exact features that you want to give to the users. Sounds great. So just for the sake of completeness, I'm sorry, again, I'm going to ask a question that is not easy to answer in audio form. Could you touch upon a bit about the top level architecture of CloudsCube?
Sure. So it is entirely high level. Actually, I can share a link. I'll send the link, as part of the show notes.
Yeah.
But I actually have a very detailed blog post that describes how everything has been laid out. But at the core, there is an Angular app. Uses a whole bunch of HTML5 canvas and other stuff to do the canvassing, canvas layouts and all that. That goes into, it's stored out of a blob storage, something like a S3 bucket, essentially.
Yeah.
So that, at the high level, that's the front end. Most of the complexity actually does reside in the front end. The front end does most of the heavy lifting. At the back end, we use a microservices model. So you have independent units of deployment and scaling. So we have web APIs, and they're authored using ASP.NET Core. They are hosted on Azure again, into something called as Azure App Service. So that's there. There are a couple of Lambda-like Azure functions that help with like thumbnail generation or adjusting the sharpness of the pictures, fonts moving, font rendering, and all that stuff. So those are all Lambda functions or Azure's equivalent of Lambda functions. Everything is all the key vault, like we use a centralized key vault for externalized configuration. So something like a KMS store in AWS. I'm just assuming that the audience is more familiar with AWS. I'm just trying to find parallels here.
Yeah, I think that's definitely useful.
It's like a KMS key value store where the apps wake up and then they fetch all these secret values like the connection strings or database passwords and all that. They fetch them out and then they bootstrap themselves. They don't write directly to the database. We use a pattern called queue-based load leveling. So essentially the idea is to queue up all your database commits into a message bus, and then you dequeue them asynchronously and then do your writes. So that reduces the load on the server to a constant level. So say for example, you have hundreds of users trying to write to the database at the same time, that very quickly you'll run out of resources. So we essentially stagger out those writes and put them in a queue and then dequeue them and do those commits. So, and then other than that, there's a whole bunch of monitoring and dashboards and alerts. So every single component we have like alerts set. So if it's a backend API, then the rate of incoming requests, rate of 500 errors for message buses, there's like any, are there any dead lettered or poisoned messages? Other things like latency in serving out content. We have all that. We have what we call yellow and red thresholds for each of them. Yellow is just a warning. Red is when something gets sent over Slack or SMS or email and wakes you up in the middle of the night to go attend to it. That's pretty much the back end. On the front end side, we have CDN. See, a lot of it is static content, right? SVG files, all those items are. So we rely on Azure CDN to go serve out. So CDN gives you the benefit of compression and caching. Azure CDN also has managed TLS certs. So everything is encrypted over the wire. The TLS offload happens at the CDN level. And other than that, the CDN also provides you with like rewriting HTTP URL rewriting capability. So HTTP to HTTPS, all that redirection happens at CDN level. And there's Azure DNS, which does the subdomain name to CDN endpoint mapping. Pretty straightforward architecture. And one more key thing is we rely on an automated CI/CD pipeline. So we use this infrastructure as code framework called Pulumi. So essentially, it's like a competitor to Terraform. We were using Terraform earlier. We migrated everything to Pulumi. So every all the resources are authored using Pulumi. And then the app deployment themselves happens through Azure DevOps, or, you know, if people are familiar with GitHub workflows and GitHub actions, Azure's equivalent of that. So we use that to deploy. So one good thing about Pulumi or Terraform scripts is you can create mirror environments. So your dev, test, pre-production, production, they can all be identical mirror images of each other. And they will only differ in key vault values, right? So your database connection string might be different, but other than that, it will be, we use the same environment replicas to test out. So that way we reduce the, you know, if you hit a bug in pre-production or in the staging environment, you are very likely to hit it in production. Or if a customer reports a bug in production, you can easily reproduce that in pre-production as well. So we keep the environments very identical, and Pulumi and Terraform, they go a great way in helping us do that. And other than that, yeah, there's a Docker container registry as well, or Azure container registry, which is like Docker Hub. And all the backend API apps are essentially Dockerized. So we rely on a whole bunch of apt-get packages. So we don't want to do zip deployments. So the easiest way to roll out those apt-get packages is with a Docker image. So we do that as well. No Kubernetes in the picture, because right now, one of the rules of thumbs is keep the things as simple as possible. It's an early stage product, right? You don't want to over invest in Kubernetes at this point, right? We are happy with the pay as you go model. So everything is PaaS or serverless. No infrastructure, no Kubernetes clusters in the picture yet. At some point, yes, this may become a bottleneck. You know, the price, we may not be able to optimize further, or we may have to get off some of the standard components into customized components. So at that point, we'll take a look at Kubernetes. But I don't want to prematurely optimize for it, because the focus has to be on app development right now, and we want to keep the DevOps and infrastructure pieces out of the way. So whatever is the easiest PaaS, we'll take it and go with it right now.
Right. Yeah, that was pretty detailed. And so related question, how big is the team, and specifically the engineering team? Is it?
No, it's just me right now.
Just you, okay. Yeah, that's what I wanted to do.
So. Couple of, on an as-needed basis, some freelancers that I engage with. Mm. So for example, like something to do with like image optimization, SVG optimization. There was some SVG optimization tool that I needed. And I didn't necessarily have the expertise in that space. Mm. And there was another person who knew about it. So engaged with them to do it. Mm. All intents and purposes, it's me right now. But once the revenue stream from the enterprise product, the paid enterprise product, starts stabilizing, I'm looking to expand that into a bigger team.
Great. Just to ask around the UI side also, so any challenges, particular challenges did you face, or did you feel like there are enough libraries to do what you wanted to do with, especially I think you're not from a front end background.
No, I'm not from a front end. UI has been my Achilles heel for,
for a lot of years.
Ago. Like I still struggle with, things like CSS, SCSS and things like that. Hmm. I have just learned to, learn on the fly and pick up things. And MDN is a great developer resource. That's how it is. It's like angular.io and MDN, right? And just sort of like pick things up by myself. And would I like to offload that UI development to a separate developer in the future? Hell yes. But for now, I'm managing it by myself. It's challenging. I'm not going to deny it, but the Angular community has been pretty good. NPM, you'll find NPM packages for most of the stuff with type declarations built in. So not been a challenge so far.
And the backend is also .NET Core, right?
The .NET Core on .NET Core, Entity Framework Core, and everything is hosted on Azure. So I'll send a link to the...
Yeah, sure. I'll add it to the show notes and also try to see if I can add something to the video as well.
Sure.
Sure. Thanks a lot, Mithun. Those are the questions that I wanted to ask you. And I think you've given great details on the tech stack and where the CloudSQ product is. I'm especially interested to try it out more and then looking forward to the enterprise plan as well.
Sure, sure, sure. And I realize, given that this is an audio podcast format, some of those things that I have not been able to articulate well verbally. So I hope the links that we send in the show notes will help people get a better understanding of.
But you did a great job in explaining the tech stack. I could having done some similar work, maybe that's the reason, but I could totally relate to it. And all the pieces were fitting together, but yes, there are some limitations. So I'll definitely make sure to give some more details as possible. Yeah.
Sure.
But I think you did a great job with explaining the architecture as well.
Thanks so much. Thank you.
Sure. Thanks a lot, Mithun. And looking forward to future features coming up, and all the best for the product.
Thank you. Thanks for this opportunity to showcase the app, talk about it. I hope the community finds it useful.
It was definitely useful for me, and I hope a few folks can get inspiration from the work that you're doing, more from a tech point of view, and also learn that there is a product like this, what you're trying to achieve, and so on. Definitely a good use case and a good learning from a tech aspect as well. Both are there. I hope few people listen to it and get some inspiration and also learn about the product.
Thanks, Manas. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks a lot again for taking the time. See you. Bye.
See you. Thank you.